thanks everybody for coming.
So we are actually videotaping and recording this, so for people who couldn't be here this evening, they'll be able to see all of you work really hard. So again, thanks for coming. This is the first of three board workshops that we're doing on our capital facilities program. And you see up on the screen a slogan or a phrase that we've adopted really in terms of lifting student achievement, every student, every day. And what that really takes is all of us to do that. And that's really our hope this evening and over the next three workshops to involve everybody in the process of determining how we're going to implement our facilities bond program. So you're going to be kind of the mappers of that program tonight. You're going to have a chance to act like a board member and determine what were the priorities you would choose in organizing the projects. You're going to work at coming to consensus with a group of other people on what the priorities would be. Because we're looking at the whole district, in the high school district, whole district, and the elementary district, not just one particular school. We're doing this because we want to make sure that it's a transparent, clean process. We don't have any preconceived notions at this point on which projects should go first, second, or third. We're going to be listening to you and other members of the community because it's the voice of staff and students and parents and community members. They're going to help us determine what those priorities are, because ultimately the Board of Education is going to have to make that decision. But they're not going to do that without your input, so that we're really clear about what the deliverables will be, what is actually going to happen. The process tonight is not about what color carpet's going to be in the classrooms, what the walls are going to be painted like, what window coverings are going to be. It's really bigger picture, just about facilities itself. It's really important about us working together, because we all represent different factions of the district. While I'm the superintendent, I'm also a parent of two kids that attend the schools. I'm also a homeowner in the district. So I wear several hats, as do many of you. And so it sounds cliche, but it really does take this village to make the decisions that we're going to do to move forward. We're going to do a lot of listening tonight. We're not going to be providing a lot of information or a lot of answers, because we don't necessarily have them yet. That's really going to be the work you're going to be doing. So when you think about facilities, our facilities serve education. Our schools, our classrooms, our buildings, they're there for a purpose, and they were developed and built to house a school and house kids and teach kids. So we now are faced, as we look at how we do school with our local control accountability plan, local control funding, the fact that we now have smarter balanced assessment and growth measure, we're implementing the Common Core. And what we've seen is that No Child Left Behind has come and gone. Sputnik has come and gone. And you can see that, just like our culture, things are changing. So, about 2 years ago, we began a process of building relationships in our community about finding out if we had support to renovate and modernize our school facilities. An 18-month planning process culminated in a long-range facilities plan being approved by the board last June. We placed a ballot measure on the ballot, and in November, thanks to the community of San Rafael, we passed measures A and B, which have now provided us $260 million of funding to do school facilities in both the elementary district and the high school district. So tonight we're gonna go over those pieces. We're gonna go over what we have, but we also need to begin talking about what are some of the limitations. One of the limitations being that it has to comply with California law to house kids. That's a non-negotiable. And there's other things that are limitations that we'll learn more about. So as you look here, school buildings, we have to keep up with the delivery of education. And I think it's one of those things that we want to hear your voice about what you think needs to be in our schools, how they look, what they feel like, and how students are using them. And we now have to look at, are our buildings sufficient to meet the needs of kids in our schools now? Or do we need to modernize them so that we can do a better job? So, I'm going to reply, it's now Sarah's turn. But I forgot to tell the point, like, you know, so, we'll go back to the little future. So, when I first started driving, I drove a Chevy Nova with very few seatbelts, an 8-track player, and not when windows you had to roll up and down, no air conditioning. And I wouldn't want to drive that car now. And so it's kind of like our classrooms and school buildings. They need to fit the times and hopefully have some bells and whistles that make it a little bit easier. And with that, now we're going to look back at the history of buildings in San Rafael with Sarah Schoening, our facilities advisor.
We won't go over the details of this, although it's really fascinating to see what has happened since this school district started about 150 years ago. Look at all of the changes that have happened recently, and look at the changes that have happened over the last 150 years. In this graph, we don't need to go into the detail, it tells a story just as it is. When were our buildings built? They mostly happened with the baby boom. So we now have buildings that are about 60 years old. They've had some renovation, but it's a challenge keeping up with education today and all of the technology and the changes that we all know our students have to go forward. About a month and a half ago, we put this slide up and said, to develop your program, you need a lot of program systems, you need a lot of documents, there's a lot of compliance you have to do. There's a lot of building that we have to get underway. You already have many solid, really good foundations. The district team and its consultants worked on a master facilities plan, and they engaged the community extensively to put together all of that visioning for you. You also know that you don't that wish list is longer and that vision is larger than the funding that you have. So that's part of the challenge that we're going through now. One of the other things that we need to keep in mind is as we go through tonight and we're beginning to set the priorities for the implementation plan, is the difference between program and projects. The program, you know what a project is. A project is, let's build a multi-purpose room, or let's build a classroom. That's a project at one site. When you have a group of projects, that's a program. So what we need to work on tonight is the program, not the projects. Later on, you're going to see that there's a chance to develop the projects individually at each school site in much more detail. But right now, what we have to do is first map the whole program and be sure we can finish the program before we put details in each site. Okay? And what our intention is that we start that in three phases. The first one is tonight, where we talk about the priorities and we get that word from you. We also need to talk about parameters. And by that we mean, what are the things that we can't change? What are the stakes that we have to put in the ground? We're going to ask you to get on board with some of those and understand that we don't have a choice with some of those things. Then next week, the team is going to compile your list of priorities over the weekend and bring those results back to you on Monday night, and also bring some test scenarios. So what would it look like if we tried to match all of the things that we have to do and try to match the priorities that you gave us feedback on tonight? Okay? Those will be what you think of as schematics. So it's just like if an architect comes to you and says, here's a schematic for your new house, and they bring you usually three of those, and you say, well, I like this part, and this part, so go away and glue them all together and make them whole, and come back with a consolidated version. So that's what we'd like, that's the process we'd like to go through on testing these scenarios. Now, site-level design. Details. Rachel was going to speak for just a moment on this. After tonight and the workshops that we're working on, we'll have a program implementation plan. But what we want you to remember is that that's not the end, and that you have a lot of work to do at your individual sites to design with the architects and with the team. And Rachel's going to talk a little bit about what the sequence of actions will be.
Okay. So these aren't listed, but they're not, there's another way of representing these. It's really a circle, because they all these different groups really contribute to each other. And it's a conversation between all of us. So to be successful, we're going to have a lot of back and forth between these. The board information, this is really the check-in. Are we doing what we said we were going to do? We're going to make sure we're looking at those project descriptions, and there's actually an official definition of what those project descriptions are. Overview of the scope, schedule, and the budget. When we talk about the project team, I think of the project team as really the experts around the table. We start looking, talking to the architects, the designers, the engineers, really specialty people in those particular areas. And the work that we're going to be doing needs to have a lot of those specialists around energy, around air conditioning, around all sorts of things. We'll be talking to specialists. We also have requirements that we have to follow in terms of CEQA, which is a regulatory piece that we have to do with every single project. There are specialists, again, who manage that process for us. We then have the third group is the school community input and collaboration. This is really, it's the teachers, it's the students, it's the parents, it's the broader community, and it's not just those that you're at your school site. You can attend any school site or a school that your kid might be going to in the future. That's really important because when you look at, we'll share a little bit later, what we're talking about in terms of planning and timing, we're looking really far ahead into a number of years. So these three groups are really dependent on each other. We'll be working closely with each other, but it's really an opportunity now that we've actually have defined the roles and responsibilities. So it's really clear to say, if I need to have a detailed conversation about the playground, where is that going to happen? School, right? That's at the school community input discussion. Everyone always is invited to a board meeting. And we will have updates around facilities all the time, I am sure. But we just need to understand where the right level of discussion and where the right level of input is going to be most efficient. And I think this is helping us start getting that definition in place. In terms of our master facility plan, Dr. Wattenpah touched on it. Many of you may remember Marcus if you participated in some of those community sessions 2 years ago, 18 months ago, where you see some of the pictures around the room, some of you are in those pictures. We are really fortunate that we did a lot of work in this space.
I thought I was up, but if not.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Hi, Marcus Simpson, my architects. We help the district develop this facilities master plan. There's copies of them around on some of the tables, and we'll talk about them later. What I was here to talk about tonight was a little bit about what we've heard so far. A lot is a lot of the process. What is the district going to be doing going forward? Is the board going to stay engaged? How are they going to make sure the community stays engaged? How are they going to make sure that there are the right people at the table to make sure that the projects are as successful as possible? So let's start with what we have. We have a master facility plan that we developed over the course of, there is a plug. it likes to spot. Over the course of about 18 months, I started here about 2 years ago, working with a variety of groups. And in that time, I've worked with over 250 people in a variety of different meetings and different sessions. And what we started with was an assessment. We met with MNO, and we physically walked every single room and every single campus. We met with site committees to talk about the educational and operational adequacy of each campus. And that's how we started. That was our starting point. What do we really have? From there, we did vision. We looked at what are the site committees and what is the community looking at in terms of the development of these sites going forward? And we specifically called them visioning meetings because that's what this master facility plan is. The what is the vision? This is where we want the facility to be. It was a relatively conservative vision. We wanted to make sure that it was something accomplishable and reasonable, but it was something that was very forward thinking. So in the process of that, we engage students, we engage teachers, we engage whole sessions of what we call an executive committee at the time, talking about right sizing schools and so on and so forth, and we ended up with a master facility plan, which is really a 30,000 foot view. So what's next? So how do we get this done? Now we have a bond, we have two bonds approved, and we need to identify how we get the money that we have, which is less than the overall cost of the plan, best plan for the San Rafael City Schools community. Over there. Back to you.
So, not to belabor that, but that's critically important work, that you have a vision. What is our goal? What's the direction we're pointed? And how are we going to get there? The implementation plan is our roadmap, and it's a living document, which is to say that it has to get revisited periodically. Imagine trying to plan education alone for 8 years. Common Core curriculum came in, and it meant a lot of testing facilities. A lot of school districts were scrambling to put that into their bond, kind of in the middle of that. There are all kinds of changes that we have to do to accommodate that. So the implementation plan that we put together will be revisited as you go through this bond program over 8 years. However, we do need to plan what we're going to do overall so that you know you have a roadmap. Can we get from here to San Diego? Do we know what our goal is, and do we have enough food and gas to get there? So once we answer those questions, then we can decide whether we're taking side trips, and we can handle the things that come up on that plan. So, and remember that we're doing this for the whole district. Now, this is what we're heading toward. This is what we want out of this implementation plan. We want something that looks like this. See that red-orange sample up there? So this is not your plan, but your plan will look like this, except, next slide. These are just sample projects, and this is an easy one. If you look at, let's go back one. Look at these projects. These are all million-dollar projects, and every school, that happens to be 10 schools and they're 10 years in this program plan, every school builds the exact same building for $1 million, and they all fit into 1 year. And 1 year we do school A, and the next year we do school B, and you just march along until you're done at the end of 10 years. So what we want to do, obviously we're not that simple. It's not going to happen quite that way, but this is a really good illustration of what we need to do. Forward one, these are not your projects. Don't look at A, B, and C and think, they must be thinking my school there. That's not what we're doing. Next. The first thing we have to do is we have to have cash to build these buildings. CBO has worked long and hard to understand what we can have based on the tax basis here, and that's a function of a tax rate times the assessed value. So you can only get the amount of revenue that you can generate in that way for GO bonds. The other thing, the other hard work that's already gone into this is identification of other funding sources. So there's Prop 39 money. Now let's take a slight walk about and talk about state funding. Nobody knows if state funding is going to work out in the fall or not. We don't know that. We're all, among the professionals, we all wonder if that's happening. It is on the ballot. The governor doesn't like it. We don't know. So we're building a conservative budget for this program that does not include very much state funding at all. However, over the course of 8 years, nobody in our profession thinks there won't be state funding. So we're building a conservative budget, not counting on very much of that, counting on, in fact, it's old state funding that we would be going after, not new state funding. So in the future, there should be good news about state funding. Not, oh my goodness, what are we going to do now that we don't have the money we were thinking we were going to have? You follow me? Okay. The next thing that we have to do is we have some set-asides that we have to do. The first one is a contingency that is at the board level or the program level. We set that money aside, and the construction team pretends that it's not there. We don't get to look at it. We run out of funds, or we want something extra for our project, that's off the table, and that's for board authorization only. So we set that aside, and that helps us smooth out some of the bumps in the road if unexpected things come up in the future. Or at the end of the program, if that money is still left, then the board has the happy dilemma of wondering what to do with extra money. The next thing that we have to set aside is we have to run the program. So we have to have both internal and external staff that run this program and manage it. Who coordinates it? We need a bunch of legal documents, so there's some attorneys involved. There are a number of functions that have to happen to manage the whole thing, and we have to pay for that. That team wants to be lean and efficient, but not so lean that things are falling off the table and getting lost. Okay, next. So now, look what happens. We march through the program. Each site gets $1 million. And here's what happens over 10 years. What happens? The cost goes up. Yeah. So in construction, that's called escalation. You and I think of it as inflation. But we know that some number of years from now, it's going to cost more. So here's the thing. We're building into this budget right now the future cost, not the present cost, and then we'll be surprised when things are more expensive and we can't finish the program. The idea is we're building that in now. Now, here's the bad news. It's escalation and cost of construction is going up. In case you haven't looked south in the last month or so, San Francisco is driving prices dramatically in the region, and we have to pay attention to that. We watch that in the industry. We watch that in We have a construction manager in the audience tonight. These are things that we talk about all the time. Where are construction costs pointed? What do we need to take into account? So we're planning that now, and unless, I don't know, the Great Depression happens again, or something really unusual happens, we should be okay. Because we're taking a conservative approach, and we're planning right now for that increase in costs every year. Okay, so the last slide on this is, see that red? We got a problem, don't we? We overspent, and you can't do that. You're not legally allowed to spend more than you can pay for it as a public school district. Public contract code says you can't hire somebody unless you have the funds to do it. So we're not allowed to overspend liquid funds that we have. We do have to spend them, but you can't overspend them. So we have to watch that cash flow, and we have to predict every year what we're going to spend and what's going to happen. Now, what are we going to do about the red that's up there now? Plan for it. What? Close your eyes. No? No, it's actually fun. You end up moving these pieces around, all of those green. Christina, can you point to the green stair step thing? There you go. If we move a few of those around, we can make the red go away. If we divide a couple of them and do part of a project here and part there, those will go away. Now, some of the thinking that's already gone into this and that I think you have seen reflected already is that, for example, some of the spaces. Well, let's just imagine if the world were perfect and it did anything we wanted on the school bond. Let's just close school for a year. All the kids are going to have a holiday. And we'll build that whole school, and then we'll come back at the end of the year. Well, that's not going to work, is it? The kids are happy, but mom and dad are not. So we have to kind of stage that for what you call swing space. Some districts happen to have a high school that's sitting around doing nothing that maybe got closed 10 years ago, and now you can bring that back online. But this district isn't large enough to have a spare high school sitting around ready for us to swing students into while we do all the construction in one place. So that's a problem. The other problem is we can't get that much money in 1 year anyway. And the next problem would be, if you could get all of your bond funds, imagine the decision load that would go on. So I can see the board has tears in their eyes right now. Imagine if you had to make that many decisions all in 1 year. So that's hard on the district. And the other thing that would do, if the world were perfect and we could have all the money up front, is the contractors in the area would have so much work to do that prices would go up and supply lines would go up. It's not a good thing to have everything at once for all kinds of reasons. So we have to go ahead and plan that, and some of your projects get divided so that you can handle what they call swing space. So you do part of a project 1 year, and then you occupy that and you move the kids to portables, or there's some spare space that you can temporarily occupy. This went into a lot of the planning and thinking already. I know I'm preaching to the choir in some places, but we want you to make sure that you understand that there are good reasons to split this, and it makes better use of the monies that you have. So we have to work through all of that. Okay. Go back one, please. We won't belabor this, but we want you to know that you have people on your team who love budgets and details and get into the weeds of all of these. Additionally, the bond program team is tracking this. The board makes sure that somebody's tracking it. Auditors make sure that somebody's tracking it. And the oversight committee helps track that as well. Now, this is the most exciting slide of the whole presentation. Anybody know what DSA is? So that's the permitting authority for California schools. This slide is full of stuff that's boring, but we want you to know that there's a lot of compliance that goes into building schools in California, and the bond team has to track that, along with attorneys and along with construction managers. It isn't really the most exciting slide in the whole presentation, but we do have to track those, and it does mean it's kind of cumbersome to run bond programs, but it's part of what makes it public construction, and it's fair to all of the contractors, et cetera, and it makes it safe. California has good, safe schools, so there's some of the things that we have to do anyway, which we will see. Let's go to one more. And now it's time for you to do some exercises. And there's no ukulele involved, I don't think. But we'd like to divide you into groups. Yes.
Try this in a second, what we're going to do here. To your comment, we're going to take the information we get from tonight, which will then feed into the next workshop. The next workshop information is going to feed into the next following workshop. At the end of the day, we're hoping, as Sarah showed on that other slide that showed the budget and showed the project slotted, that we're able to show that vision for both the elementary school district and the high school district. So that really is the process. So we're starting tonight, and we just describe a little bit of what's happening here and see if this addresses your question around process. So we're now at work with the fun part of the evening, I think.
Yeah, please. So just in terms of this process, I think a couple things. One is we're going to push information out to the school sites, both in English and Spanish, in terms of what happened this evening. And that information will go out to all of our staff, all of our community members, with opportunities to, if they want to take one of these ranking sheets and fill it out themselves, they will have that opportunity to do that as well. Part of the process is we need to wrap up getting the priority set because we would like to break ground on some projects in the summer of 17. If we don't get that, the priority set, we won't be in time to have construction start in the summer of 17. So we want to set the priorities for both the high school and the elementary district. It's might be a little more challenging in the elementary, but our goal really is to move through this process, get as much input and feedback as we can, so that we can at least begin.
Question is, when do we next need to set the priorities by?
By the end of this workshop session. End of the three workshops.
As soon as possible. We need to get the architects in. We need to get the input from the community and the school sites to make summer of 2017. We got to circle. I'd like to welcome Supervisor David Connolly, who's joined us this evening, and Natu Tuataloa and Justin Pashona. All right, what we're doing here this evening is, this is the prioritization, one tool around prioritization. So this is really identifying what is driving some of these decisions. Now, we have the list of the givens, so you don't have to worry, are our buildings going to be seismically safe? Can they withstand an earthquake? We have to do that, right? So we want to make sure we put those pieces on the side. We're going to have the experts make sure we're doing that, and if they don't, we're in a bigger trouble. We have to look at the other side. And the board's job for our 7,212 students is to make sure we are looking across the entire district, and that's today's number, of how many students we serve. And it's larger when you think of parents, and it's larger when you think of the entire community. It's a large community and a lot of voices. And so we're here to represent all that. So the five of us could go off and just go through and say, here, we pick the priorities, we're done. Okay, but that doesn't make sense. We could say, the items at the lowest cost that fit into that budget right, that's how we're going to slot this all in. Well, that doesn't make sense either. We could say we're just going to listen to the loudest group. That really doesn't make sense, right? We have to, because of our entire community, we represent the whole community. And so one of the tools we would like to use is the results of the work that we're going to do tonight, and you're going to do tonight, is helping us rank these priorities. So we're going to walk through, who's going to describe, is Christina or Sarah? Do you want to walk through what the process is going to be? Yes. All of these are really good. There's nothing wrong on this list.
Can we separate forms for the high school district and the elementary district, or are we putting priorities like student comments next to play space when they're not really in the same?
You'll see on the form that you're able to identify which school or even district that you're representing, and then we will look at that information to be able to separate them.
So at your table, if you're going to work primarily in elementary, submit that as well as for high school. You can do both.
So part of when you fill out a survey or you do something, you can be influenced by the people around you. Because you can look and see, oh, I didn't pick that, but that might be a good idea, so I'm going to change mine. So when you get your initial form, we would like you to think about, just for yourself, what are your top 7 priorities? For the elementary district or the high school district? Before you then work in a small group and share and see if you can come to consensus on what the top 7 are. When it's all said and done, the 5 elected board members are going to have to do this process. They're going to have to identify what they have heard are the top priorities, and then come to consensus among the 5 of them, with a majority determining what the priorities are going to be. So tonight you get to pretend you're a board member and pretend you're making the decision for yourself, but then you have to convince at least 2 other friends for consensus. We're going to hand these out. They're in English and Spanish, front and back. Ideally, we're looking for groups of 5, 6, 7 from different school sites, because we hopefully have different perspectives. So we're going to let you self-select and sort yourself into those groups. There's tables in the back to work if you want to pull some chairs around together to do that. Yes, sir.
Before we break up, I mean, some of these things are not clear to definition. Like, I'm not sure what a college and career readiness, what a capital expenditure that's going to affect directly college and career readiness is.
I would look at it from a facilities point of view, that we're going to ensure there's space for college and career readiness programs on the school site. Yes, sir. We don't, because we're trying to get, first of all, so if we go through this process and flex space doesn't even come to the top, Then we want to look at how do we define those spaces for people, because this really was just a laundry list of things that we've heard, things that we've heard people say, things that were in parts of the rationale and ballot language. And there might be some things we haven't thought of that you can put those down as well. There's a blank spot for comments. Tom.
Want those of us who might be interested in elementary district from different sites to get together and I can't imagine why I would want to, what we need at Davidson may not match what a Sun Valley needs or a Glenwood. So
you're right. And so the choices that have to be made are about the entire district. That's what the board's going to have to do.
Why?
Because that's the decision the board's going to have to make in terms of looking at all 7,200 kids, looking at all the school sites, hearing what's going to happen first.
So if the elementary district, majority of people say play space is important, then Davidson has to get play space too?
Not necessarily. So what we're trying to identify is to narrow down the number of priorities that the board would consider in looking at all of the projects. And thinking about other school sites. Because that's what the board has to do as well. Marcus is going to help.
Okay. I'm going to try. No guarantees. So you're exactly right. The needs of Davidson are going to be very different than the needs of Sun Valley, than the needs of San Pedro, than the needs at Bahia Vista. What we're hoping to get is a consensus around what are the priorities from this group here to represent the district. Then what we will do is we will take that information, go into the master facility plan, and identify projects that we think fit those priorities. And we'll have several options for you. So the idea is that when we come back on Monday, you'll see a version that has, I start making things up because as soon as I start doing it, wait a minute, I didn't get that. But we'll have a version where Davidson gets more play space, or a version where Davidson doesn't, as an example, since you use that. And the idea being is that we can look at these, I like that in Davidson that it did get more play space, but I also like this option over here where San Pedro also got more play space, but Davidson doesn't need it as much, so maybe this is a better fit over here. So we're gonna come back with scenarios that hopefully then we can start to gel the priorities into an actual list of projects so that we can look at the entire program together.
I mean, I think you can look at it another way in terms of, so library media center. Do you think all schools in the district should have a library media center?
Yes.
Is that a priority? Do you think all schools should have lunch facilities? So it's forcing the choice in terms of what you think those priorities are. For some, lunch facilities might not be so important, but play space is. So it's looking at across the whole district, would we want all kids, all staff, all families to have access to these things at every school if that was possible? And I can guarantee you, all of our schools don't have all of these things. Yes, sir?
Can you just explain that parity and some things?
So I think that looking at parity, so I guess it's kind of relevant what I just said. Should all schools have similar functions, similar facilities? Submit it as part of as another thing to consider in the blank spot. Yep.
What are program improvements?
So, what are we thinking? Okay, we're asking Marcus.
Program improvements would be things like art classrooms, science labs. Things of that nature. For example, at Davidson, their program includes additional science labs.
That's awfully broad.
I agree. It's very broad.
I feel like we're getting very, very broad here. And we're looking at, I'm speaking from my perspective here at Venetia Valley, specifics are important even at this stage. And I feel like even having that is getting just too broad.
Well, I think that's really the purpose, though, because the board has to look at the entire school district. And so we're hoping that you're going to provide some insights and guidance on that. And maybe you're not. Maybe you're going to provide only for the perspective from your school site. We're asking you to look at the whole district if that's possible.
Ultimately, the board's going to have to make some decisions about which projects go forward and which projects do not, based on the amount of funding that's available. And they're going to need some criteria. So whether it's the items on the list here, you see there's some blanks, and just because there are two doesn't mean you can only come up with two additional. The idea is, let's give the board some feedback about what's important to the community at large, so that the board can then hear, okay, the trickle-up economics, hopefully, is that they work in here, but that's what's important to the people here. So let's take that into consideration as we're making decisions as we go forward. And the idea is that the people here or whoever attends the upcoming meetings will all be involved in the process. So it's collectively a community process, identifying what's important to the community so that we can make decisions, or the board rather, can make decisions that meet the needs of the community.
So we're going to ask that you divide in groups and start working, because otherwise we're not going to get anything from you. And we recognize that this process may not be a perfect process, but what we're hoping is to get some feedback about what are the consensus of the people in this room, what the priorities are for schools across the district. And then that will lay the framework or the foundation for the next meeting, which is where we can have to get probably more specific.
Let's spend about 10 minutes trying to prioritize individually. So don't talk to your buddies at the table, and try to divide yourselves into, let's say, elementary school is over there, and high school over here. And it'll be one group for each table, so the tables are two together. So there'll be 10 groups in all. So try to form a group that has as many different schools as you can. And don't talk to each other, but first put your individual preferences down. Then see what it's like to try and come to consensus. And we'll blow the whistle in about 10 minutes after you sit down and start scribbling.
I see you in action.